Welcome back to the 14th installment in the Devlog Saga. Since the last episode, I've added ranged combat to the game, including an accurate simulation of projectile physics, as well as I've gone back and really improved the unit behavior in large battles, such as how they find targets and things like that. The long version is up ahead.
And I can give a fuck what category you place me. Long as when I'm pushing up daisies and gone, as long as you place me amongst one of them greats. When I hit the heavenly gates, I'll be cool beside Jay-Z.
So the first thing I had to do was implement some logic to make a ranged unit face his target. But unfortunately, that involved rotations, which involved quaternions. So naturally, the result of the first attempt is what you guys see right here. So after a bit of time fighting with the code and completely failing to understand how quaternions work, I did somehow manage to fix the problem and get the turning logic to work correctly. So here, this ranged unit will basically always turn to face towards the nearest target within its firing range, no matter what its original direction is. And then
here are the nominees for achievement in sound mixing.
Boom. Boom. Pachow. So the projectiles follow parabolic motion, which just involves some high school physics to use the equations of motion to compute the position of every single projectile during every single tick. And the positions are updated at a fixed frequency of 30 hertz. And also, all the projectiles undergo collision testing against other entities. And what this allows is basically to, you know, dodge projectiles. So here we see that when I have this rider unit in motion, the towers keep firing at his position, but so long as he's moving, he can dodge most of the shots that get fired. And I really like this because this opens the door for a lot of micro, which, you know, makes the game more fun. It lets you squeeze more power out of your units with skill and craftsmanship. And I took one extra step and I exposed creating projectiles to the scripting API. And here, all I do is I spawn projectiles with a fireball model under my mouse and fire them off, and they just damage everything in their path. So it's this kind of easy to create, you know, rain of fire effect. And I think there's a ton of use cases for this primitive, right? Custom spells, boss attacks, like traps. As long as you can spawn a custom projectile, specify the model, the speed, the direction, and hook into the collision event, I really think that, you know, the sky's the limit with what you can achieve. So the next thing I'm going to work on is to get combat between groups of units to behave better. Because in the current build, there's definitely some issues. The first of which is, if I give these guys a move, an attack move command in front of this gang of enemies, they'll make a beeline there, which makes sense. But if I give an attack move command behind this gang of enemies, as is more natural to RTS players, then they end up, you know, making this path basically going around. And the reason for that is simply because all the stationary units act as regular old blockers from the point of view of the pathfinding system. And furthermore, they act as vision blockers, meaning that, you know, these units will not be in direct line of sight of their destination. So if this was, you know, a big pile of rocks or something, then what these guys are doing would actually be, you know, quite intelligent. They're taking, you know, the optimal path by directly, you know, going around this pile. But since this is a gang of, you know, obvious enemies that I just told them to attack, what they're doing is actually retarded. So that's going to need to be fixed. And furthermore, when you guys see the actual combat take place, it's like, it starts off looking okay, but there's some obvious issues. Like, these guys at the back are just chilling. They're not, you know, they're kind of being slow. They're waiting for too long. They're not making surrounds as fast as I would like them to be making them. So I'm gonna take a closer look at these combat state machines and see if I could, you know, increase the IQ level of these soldiers. And I'm gonna mention one more issue that exists in the current combat system. And you guys can see it right here. So for finding targets for groups of units, I use something that I call an attraction field or an enemy seek field. And I basically generate a field where every eligible enemy for a faction becomes like a target. And any unit which ends up in this field ends up getting pulled towards the closest possible enemy towards it. And I really like this approach for two reasons. One, it will find optimal paths for every unit that's in this field. And two, it scales well for high number of units. So irregardless of how many units I have in combat, I only have to recompute this field up to once per tick for every single faction. Now the problem, as you guys can probably already caught on with this example, happens because I only compute this field on a per chunk basis. So it will guide enemies either towards you know, eligible targets within that chunk or the closest chunk holding enemies if there's no enemies in this chunk. And obviously, right, as this example shows, you know, there's issues with that approach, right? Such as when you have enemies right over the edge, right outside the chunk bounds, that would be, you know, optimal targets. And I do have some if statement logic, which, you know, causes these guys to hop over the boundary. But that is, you know, both kind of an ugly solution, and it doesn't always work. So I'm going to go back and fix this such that this enemy seek field will, you know, carry information across chunk boundaries. And for every single tile, it will give an optimal result. Because aside from that, as you guys can see here, I actually think it works quite well. I think it's a pretty good approach for finding targets. So I'm just going to take a quick interlude to talk about the problem of carrying information across chunk boundaries, because I think that's quite an interesting problem. So my map is split up into tiles, and groupings of tiles and are further split up into chunks, as is commonly done. The purpose of this is basically for to increase efficiency, to perform certain computations only for the subset of chunks for which that information is required. And here, I want the green units to attack the closest possible enemy units. And I have, as I mentioned, I use a field to direct the units towards the closest target. But here I have two conflicting desires. I both want to only compute the field for this center chunk, in this case, you know, 1/9 of the map, but potentially, you know, on a 200 by 200 map, the savings are, you know, exponentially greater. But I also want to make use of information that's outside of this particular chunk. So the way I achieve that is I come up with a padding distance. And the padding distance has to be large enough such that, you know, no unit in the chunk ever wants to target anything that's outside the padded field, right? And, you know, that depends on your field size, your engine, things like that. Then what I do is I treat this larger padded field as, you know, a regular chunk field. I compute the integration field, then the flow field that will guide any entity within the field towards its target or targets. And lastly, to make this field a standard sized field that fits nicely into my engine code, I just discard the information that's outside the original chunk boundaries. So I'm going to demo my solution by showing a pretty sophisticated pathfinding use case in action, but nonetheless, it's a use case which can easily arise during ordinary gameplay. So I'm going to take this gang of units here and attack move them to this settlement. So we see they're going to make their way and immediately start attacking the peasants. So let's quickly get these bear riders, get them to help, get some of these ranged units, get them to flank from the west. Furthermore, let's get these guys and get them to flank from the north. And let's watch the battle play out. So when everything's said and done, basically every single group of units that I told to auto attack, they got to their final auto attack destination. And during the combat, everything generally looked pretty clean. Everybody was attacking, everybody they were supposed to be attacking, and you know, no one really got super confused. And even these peasants, they kept doing their thing, right? They kept executing their harvesting logic, even in the presence of, you know, craziness going on around them. When some storage sites died, when, you know, their pathing got blocked, they still generally, you know, did the correct things. And I think this really shows, you know, the true challenge of an RTS pathfinding system. Basically, in the presence of very many dynamic obstacles, in the presence of, you know, rapidly changing dynamic conditions, large groups of units keep doing what they're supposed to be doing, and the overall big picture continues to look pretty clean. And I think to some degree I have achieved that here, as evidenced by the last clip that you guys saw. So before I finish off this video, I'm just going to give you guys a quick roadmap of where I'm headed next with the project. So finally, at this point, I can say with a clean conscience that I've made my own real-time strategy game engine. The feature set is all there, the boxes are checked, and although it's not perfect, I feel like the code is in a really good place, such that going forward, I can continue iterating on it, perfecting it, and adding new features. But in the immediate future, I'm not going to be adding any new big features to the engine. I'm going to be focusing on putting out a new build of the demo within the next couple of weeks, to put together a new trailer shortly after, and to work really hard to put out an Everglory early access build this April. So get excited for that.
For every single diehard fan who embraced me, I'm thankful for the talent in which God gave me, and I'm thankful for the environment that he placed me. Believe it or not, I thank my mom for, she raised me.